I'm Vince Vitkowski. I'm chair of the Society's International and National Security Law Practice Group, and welcome to our panel on cybersecurity. This is the first time that the National Lawyers Convention has addressed this subject, so I'll start with just a few seconds of cyber highlights. In 2003, the Bush administration released the first national security strategy to secure cyberspace. That identified some of the threats and vulnerabilities and developed the concept of the private-public partnership for cyber defense. 2007, TJ Maxx revealed the data breach that exposed the debit and credit card information of 45.6 million customers. That brought one type of cyber risk into widespread public attention. 2010, the existence of the Stuxnet virus was revealed. That was the virus that slowed down Iran's nuclear program by incapacitating, to some extent, its nuclear reactors. That brought to widespread public attention the possibility of industrial threat cyber attacks that had kinetic effects or physical effects. In 2012, then State Department legal advisor Harold Koh announced the U.S. Policy that the law of armed conflict applied in cyberspace. That meant that cyber attacks could warrant a military response up to and including bombs and missiles. Later that year, then Secretary of Defense Leon Panetta warned, and I'm going to quote, of a cyber Pearl Harbor that would cause physical destruction and the loss of life, an attack that would paralyze and shock the nation and create a profound sense of vulnerability. Also in 2012, there was a failed attempt to pass cybersecurity legislation, which failed because of policy differences. Now, those differences do not run along traditional ideological spectrums. They're really all across the political spectrum. In 2013, cyber attacks were the first identified global threat in the U.S. intelligence community's worldwide threat assessment. In her farewell address, then Secretary of Homeland Security, Janet Napolitano said, and again I quote, "Our country will at some point face a major cyber event that will have a serious effect on our lives, our economy, and the everyday functioning of our society." And now in another milestone, today the Federal Society has convened a blue chip panel to address, to address these issues. It's my pleasure to introduce that panel. I'll just go right down the row. Steve Bradbury is a partner in Dechert. He served in the Justice Department from 2004 to 2009. He was head of the Office of Legal Counsel. He wrote many of the pioneering legal memoranda that relate to the subjects that we're going to be addressing today. Joel Brenner is in private practice with his own firm. He has served at different times as Inspector General of the NSA, as Senior Counsel at the NSA, and as Head of Counterintelligence under the Director of National Intelligence. He's been awarded the Intelligence Community Achievement Medal. He's written a terrific book. The book was originally called America the Vulnerable, Inside the New Threat Matrix of Digital Espionage, Crime, and Warfare. The paperback has been renamed, having to do with, I think, Google searches and having things pop up with certain readers, Glass Houses, Privacy, Secrecy, and Cyber Insecurity in a Transparent World. In any form, it's a terrific book, and I recommend it highly. Michelle Richardson is legislative counsel for the Washington Office of the American Civil Liberties Union. She focuses on national security, including cybersecurity. Before that, she was counsel at the House Judiciary Committee. And she's also a fellow at the Stanford Law School Center for Internet and Society. Paul Rosenzweig, he's the principal of, what to say about Paul? He's the principal of Red Branch Consulting, a senior consultant to the Chertoff Group. At the Department of Homeland Security, he was Assistant Secretary for Policy. Paul is everywhere in cyberspace. He's consulting, working at the think tanks, teaching, testifying before the House and Senate, blogging on lawfare. He's the leading lead cyber blogger for Lawfare, and even writing old-style papers and books. Two of his books I wanted to highlight. One is Cyber Warfare, How Conflicts in Cyberspace Are Challenging America and Changing the World. Again, a terrific overview. And then National Security Laws in the News, A Guide for Scholars, Journalists, and Policymakers, which is so much more than that because it is the essential introduction to just so many national security issues. Recommend them highly. There is on the way out a list of recommended books that our practice group has put together across the spectrum that are worth your time and attention, and all of these three books are on that list. One more thing, Paul's been the go-to guy for the society's programming on cyber. Yeah. He's spoken at many events for us. He's been an endless font of, whenever I've called, and I've called an awful lot, of ideas and experts and topics, and I just wanted to thank Paul for that. John is, of course, another great friend of the society. He's a law professor at Berkeley, a visiting professor at the American Enterprise Institute. He clerked for Judge Silberman and Justice Thomas. Did I mention that? Steve also clerked for Justice Thomas? Anyway. John served as general counsel of the Senate Judiciary Committee, and he served in the Office of Legal Counsel at Justice, where he made vital contributions to the full range of national security issues that arose after 9/11. What we're going to do is not have a talking head format, but try to have a discussion format with questions directed to the various panelists. And I'll start by asking Paul, what are the types of cyber incidents that arise? How seriously should we take them? Which ones rise to the level of a national security threat?
Great. Thank you very much for inviting me, Vince. I appreciate it. Neil DeFrancesco said yesterday that you've really made it when you get to be up on the dais at one of the Federalist Society events. It's my first time, and I thank you. What we have up here is cyberspace, circa 2005, a mapping effort that was done at the time. And it gives you some idea of the scope and degree of risk in cyberspace, as well as the scope and degree of its wonderful opportunity to create new economies. It's what powers Amazon and Walmart, and we shouldn't, as we talk about threats and vulnerabilities, lose sight of everything that's great that's happening. But since this is a cybersecurity panel, I want to ask two questions in this opening set of remarks. What's vulnerable, and who's threatening it? The answer to the question, what's vulnerable, is essentially everything. Anything that has a silicon chip that is programmable and addressable is, at least in theory, subject to being hacked. I have seen demonstrations of vulnerability in everything ranging from heart monitors to the electric grid. Back in June of this past year, at a hacker conference in Las Vegas known as DEF CON, some security researchers demonstrated their ability to crack the security on a commonly implanted type of heart monitor, causing it to misfunction in a way that, if they'd done it to a real person, would have killed the owner of the monitor. Right? That's pretty shocking, but it's a very small bore kind of threat, right? On the other end, we see threats to the national electric grid. Just yesterday, the North American Electricity Reliability Council, which is responsible for the reliability of the entire North American grid, completed a red team exercise called GridX2, in which at the end of 2 days of effort, which involved a fictitious 2 months of simulated attack on the American electric grid, tens of millions of Americans were still without power, and over 150 people had been killed. Now, these vulnerabilities are theoretical, and when they're so comprehensive and widespread, you almost despair of any opportunity to address them. If everything is at risk, how can we protect it all? We surely can't. We don't have the resources. That leads us to try and prioritize our efforts by thinking about what the consequences are of cyber vulnerabilities and who the threat actors are. And there, unfortunately, I think, there's a dissonance. The most common sets of threats, the ones that happen to you and I most frequently, are in the end the ones that are least likely to have existential consequences. While the rarest threats are the ones that we hope will never happen at all, are obviously the ones that will have the most significant consequence to our country. So we see, for example, that the most common threat, the one that would you and I would experience most, is crime. And crime in cyberspace is rampant and endemic, just as it is in the real world. The best estimates I've seen are between $100 to $300 billion a year in losses to the US economy annually. About 500,000 jobs are at risk. But if that were the only threat, we wouldn't be having a panel here today, because of course, that's a commonality of crime that we can address with traditional criminal tools, probably. So the next thing that we worry about is espionage. And granted, there's a fuzzy line between crime and espionage, because the theft of intellectual property from a commercial actor looks a lot like espionage in the national security space. But here, we start to see a lot more significant potential threats to American national security. The Defense Science Board, reporting to the Secretary of Defense, reported in a classified study earlier this year, and when I say classified, I mean it was secret until it was leaked to the Washington Post, reported that over 50 different important developmental military programs had been penetrated by Chinese intrusions and data exfiltrated. And these intrusions ranged from things like the designs for our next stealth fighter, the F-22, to something called micro-nano proto-metallic armor, which I don't know what it is, and I'm glad we're building it because I hope our troops get it, but I'm really kind of upset that the Chinese have stolen it from us already before we've even deployed it. But what's really driving people nuts at the policy level and at the lawmaking level is the series of threats that haven't yet been realized. The threats from non-state actors like Al-Qaeda or perhaps hacker groups that go by names like Anonymous or LulzSec, and the threats from nation-state actors like China. The idea that at some point in time we might get into a physical conflict with China over, say, the Taiwan, over Taiwan, and at the same time, China might as well threaten the electric grid on the west coast of the United States, or our transportation system, or something of that nature. Now, to be fair, I find those threats about as realistic as I find the threat of physical war with China, which is that it seems to me it's a pretty low degree of threat in the current environment. But at the same time, you have to accept that it's not, that judgment is based upon my assessment, if you will, not of Chinese capabilities, because certainly those capabilities and vulnerabilities exist, but rather their intentions. And if we're betting the farm or betting American security on my capability or the government's capability to assess intentionality, we're making some pretty risky investments if we assure ourselves that it can't possibly come to pass that the Chinese will take down the air traffic control system in the United States. So that's the American vision of threats and vulnerabilities. It ranges from crime to espionage to non-state actors to war. But I want to conclude by at least nodding in the direction of the fact that that's just our vision. And the internet, cyberspace, is an international domain. It spans the globe. There are more than 2.5 people who are attached to it. And ours is not the only vision of vulnerability that we need to take into account when we talk about this space. It's been reported, for example, that senior Chinese officials have said in meetings with the US government that they think that Facebook is an American plot. Now, when you think about that, your first reaction is to laugh. You know, Mark Zuckerberg taking orders from Barack Obama, it's not happening. But what it does capture is the reality for the Chinese that their threat picture looks completely different. They're not worried about espionage because they don't think they have a lot that we are going to steal. Right? And they're not worried about the war paradigm because they're pretty confident that we're not going to fire the first shot. What they're worried about is information operations, the destabilizing influence of information on their culture and their status quo. And they see Facebook and Twitter and social media and the freedom of the internet itself as an essential threat to their authoritarian regimes. And to be honest, if we are honest with ourselves, we see that too. We believe that the freedom of speech will broaden the expression of rule of law and American values in ways that would, in fact, if it were exposed to the Chinese, destabilize their regime. So in some sense, when they say Facebook is an American plot, they may actually be onto something. And whether they are or not, in defining the threat structures and what we want to address in terms of cybersecurity, it's incumbent upon us to realize that others have different views of what they consider the threats than the American government might.
Thank you. Joel and Michelle, would you let us have your take on this question?
Yeah, if the internet is a fundamentally porous and insecure system, it was invented in the late 1960s as a way to exchange information between the DOD scientists and scientists at a few American universities. They thought about putting a security layer into it. They decided not to. And they decided not to because it was pointless. Until 1992, you could not use the internet for commercial purposes under federal law. Once that changed in 1992 by Congress, we began to turn this same porous and insecure system on which identity is uncertain and in which operational code can be inserted like mere content. And we've made it the backbone of personal finance, corporate finance, governmental operations, corporate operations, the HVA system in this building and everything else. That is what underlies Paul's conclusion that everything is vulnerable. We face two fundamental issues at a national security level from this condition. The first is the insecurity of our infrastructure, because if you can penetrate a system from thousands of miles away to steal information from it, and I'll come to that in a minute, then you can penetrate it from thousands of miles away or with an insider to corrupt the system, to wipe the information clean from it, to change the information on it and destroy trust in the system, or to bring it down altogether. We're going to talk more about infrastructure later, so I won't dwell on that. The second major issue we have is wholesale espionage. In my time as the National Counterintelligence Executive, espionage went from a retail to a wholesale business. You can now steal unimaginably large quantities of information with thumb drives or remotely by bleeding it out. The government has the usual, typical politico-military espionage to worry about, but we now have the relentless focus on our private sector, which means we are losing intellectual property at a rapid clip. Quantifying the clip is difficult, but it is very large, and it is costing jobs and prosperity. That's my quick take on it, Vince. Thank you.
Michelle?
Well, I agree with the way Paul described cybersecurity. It's becoming a broader and broader catch-all to describe any wrongdoing on or over the internet, any mismanagement of digital information, and it has huge implications for where our law and policy is going. You can start with national security threats and some of these core threats and build out sort of a tiered approach. And it's important not just to find our priorities and where we need to start, but how we're going to gauge the government's authorities to respond to these threats. While you have national security maybe at your base, you then have critical infrastructure in the government, then everyday crime, and then things that are really truly just nuisance activities that don't actually harm anyone. It's very important that we don't let the authorities that we want to grant for national security and homeland security purposes to bleed into domestic and civilian uses of cybersecurity programs. We must keep them separate. I know this is incredibly hard with the internet and that national boundaries don't quite work in that context. But some of the proposals that we're looking at and Congress is considering significantly blur those lines, which is a problem. I think why you see this, though, is there are a lot of incentives here to keep the definition of cybersecurity expanding, ever expanding. One, on the government side, if you put the word cyber in front of any program, that means there's dollars attached, right? Everybody knows this is the future of national security, and in fact, the new FBI director testified just yesterday that cybersecurity threats have outpaced terrorism as the number one threat to the United States. And this is where government is headed, in some ways rightfully so. But there are incentives there. I think you also see incentives for the companies who are going to make a lot of money selling back the cyber solutions to the government. And then finally, the press. They will call anything a cyber attack. There could be a nuisance, you know, DDoS attack that will delay your bank login for 10 seconds and will be the front page of the newspaper about a cyber attack on a major financial institution, and really making these things sound very fantastical, even though they're quite minor. If these all weren't attached and had serious implications to expanding government authorities, it would be one thing. But as we see this move forward in the policy area, we have to be very careful that cybersecurity doesn't become too broad of a term.
Thank you. And Michelle, staying with you, one of the defense mechanisms is referred to broadly as information sharing. Could you explain what that is, whether you think it's a good idea, what the privacy implications are, and what else would you be thinking about when we hear that phrase?
Sure. So there are many different proposals out there about how we're going to start addressing cybersecurity and all the different pieces of it. They range everything from educating a new workforce. There are literally thousands of cybersecurity jobs that remain unfilled right now because we don't have people trained to fill them. Educating the public. Regulation, which I think we're going to talk about later. Reorganizing our own government to make sure that there is DHS or other control and coordination of all of our government websites. But one of the most controversial issues that has come up over the last couple of years is information sharing. And this is the idea that people should be able to report wrongdoing on the internet. This could be at an individual level, but really they want to go to the next step, and that the owners and operators of the internet and internet services are directly allowed to report cybersecurity problems. Now, in and of itself, that doesn't sound like a bad idea, right? The problem is always in the details and how this is going to be implemented. The proposal is to repeal all current privacy laws that apply to the internet, and say that for cybersecurity purposes, companies can share with each other or with the government whatever they deem relevant to cybersecurity. Not just records, but content of communications and other sensitive information, and that they would have no duty to minimize out personally identifiable information or other sensitive material. These proposals have been around for a couple of years. Most disturbingly, they are not in response to any actual information that there are barriers to information sharing right now. I've sat through dozens of cybersecurity hearings and heard companies and government officials call for a relaxation of our privacy laws, yet have not heard a single example of how a threat could have been stopped if information had been shared. There's also a lack of clarity about what the impact is of this. The government has said these sorts of proposals would affect over 50 different privacy laws, but they refuse to give a list of what those are and what the implications would be. It's not just privacy laws on the internet, but we're talking about HIPAA for medical records, your financial records, all sorts of information, anything that touches the internet whatsoever. This doesn't mean that information sharing is writ large going to be a problem. There are ways to share information in smart and targeted ways that get at sharing information that does reflect a cyber threat, but doesn't sweep in a bunch of innocent internet behavior or the victims themselves. The idea is that you want to create a very limited exception to current laws, require limited sharing of cyber threat information that's been stripped of personally identifiable information, unless it's actually necessary to understand the threat. You want strict use limitations. So once companies and government officials get this information, that it can only be used for cybersecurity purposes, we don't see that it turns into something like the NSA collection programs, where it can be repurposed for totally unrelated things. It should be clear that as we talk about information sharing going forward, the very broad proposals, it's called CISPA in the House, it's a bill that's passed the House 2 years in a row now, they do not apply just to advanced persistent threats. You know, some of the examples they gave about attacks on the electric grid. This isn't just about China stealing our secrets. It really is about any cybersecurity threat in the broadest sense of that term. And so even just everyday basic criminal activity or nuisance behavior is enough to trigger this exception to our privacy laws and encourage sharing this information broadly with the government. Finally, I think when you look at information sharing, there's another thing that you really need to keep an eye out for, and that's that in the civilian sphere, civilian agencies keep control over domestic programs. One of the biggest criticisms about information sharing proposals over the last couple of years has been that information can go to anyone, including the NSA or other military agencies, even when the information reflects Americans and purely domestic activities. Those sorts of misconduct and illegal behaviors should be reported to civilian agencies like DHS or the FBI. There are actually many ways already under law that you can report these sorts of activities, and this should not become a way to further militarize the domestic internet. It's incredibly important that civilians keep control of it.
Steve, you wrestled with these issues at OLC. What are your thoughts?
Well, I think we have to understand that information sharing has to be an essential element of effective cybersecurity. And if we prevent, if we fail to have the necessary debates in Congress to come up with a compromise set of changes to existing statutory privacy restrictions, then we are really hobbling our ability to protect vital systems. For example, the federal government is developing systems to screen internet interfaces for U.S. government networks to try to detect hostile intrusions. And they need to be able to do that. They need information about what are called the signatures of those hostile sources or intrusions. They leave fingerprints, if you will, codes that are characteristic of a particular foreign government or organization that's attempting to infiltrate the networks. Private companies in the U.S. have a lot of information about those signatures because they are the object of a lot of attempted infiltration. So companies that design virus software, they understand a lot of information about those signatures. So do the administrators of networks, private networks, for vital networks and not so vital but important private networks. We have to have the ability for those private parties to share that information with the government in order to be able to protect the systems, starting with the government systems, but also private critical infrastructure computer systems. Today we have very strict laws like the Electronic Communications Privacy Act and the Stored Information Act that restrict the ability of systems operators to share information with the government. And I don't think we should assume that the alternative is to completely sweep away those restrictions and allow unrestricted sharing. But it is vital that we have this debate and come up with a compromise set of rules that will enable some sharing. In addition, I don't think it's helpful to talk about weaponizing or militarizing the internet or excluding the NSA and its computer capabilities and experience from any access to such data. We need systems to work together so that we can really have effective protections. Unfortunately, however, I think with the Snowden leaks and with the raging debate and reaction in the public to anything NSA and anything related to data, et cetera, I see very little hope right now in the current climate that there will be an effective statutory solution. So unfortunately, I think the problem and the vulnerabilities are only going to persist and become even more worrisome.
Let me expand on that a little bit. I thought, by the way, that the ACLU's contribution to the CISPA debate was very important in limiting the kinds of information that would be subject to it. But let me expand on what Steve said about why information's sharing significant. If you go into a watch floor at NSA, you see enormous amounts of, it's like looking at an EKG for all the systems that that agency's responsible for. If you wanted to see how a potential slow-moving attack was rolling out against the North American electricity grid, you can't do it. There's no place to do it. There's no place to do it for any particular vertical, economic vertical, whether it's the financial system, the banking, the trading system, the banking system, big government contractors, and so on. The point is that having information be able to flow between companies in a sector, and to some degree between that sector, certain sectors in the government, is very important. It's fundamentally right to begin with the proposition that it's better to have civilian agencies do these things than government agencies. But although I think, frankly, NSA is a hybrid, but no organization in the United States government begins to have the competence to do this that NSA has. That's just a fact. And we don't have either, we don't have the human or other or monetary resources to duplicate it. Let me say finally something different about information sharing. The usual complaint in the private sector is that the government doesn't share these signatures enough with the private sector. And of course, the reason it doesn't share many of them, especially the most important ones, is that once they're shared with our private sector, they're in Beijing and Tehran and Moscow by the time the sun goes down. And so that we lose a lot of intelligence. It's a very difficult problem. But you don't hear much conversation about why there isn't better sharing at the corporate level between companies in the same vertical or from we're talking about private up. I mean, you have public to private to public, and private to private. All these things produce a degree of situational awareness that's tremendously important. But Steve's right. This is not going to have a legislative fix anytime soon. And the question is whether we can do something at a, I think, less satisfactory, smaller, localized way within particular economic verticals.
On a national defense level, one of the proposals most under consideration, or always under consideration, is generally referred to as active defense, or you might think of it as a hackback. We're going to ask John Yu to expand on the concept. What is active defense? What are the legal structures that govern its use? What don't we have that we need?
First, I want to thank Vince for putting this panel together and inviting me. Vince has been a real thinker about cybersecurity, really helped us, the Federal Society, work together to figure out what's going on. Vince always reminds me a little bit of other corporate lawyer who had a big effect on foreign policy, Dean Acheson, but without the sexy mustache. And so whenever I see Vince, I think of Dean Acheson. I don't know why. It's strange.
The image I'll never get out of my head now, John.
Exactly. So I actually think that we should launch immediate cyber attacks on North Korea, Syria, and Iran, and force all their citizens to sign up for healthcare on the healthcare.gov website. I think this would be an enormous, devastating economic strike on all of those countries. And look at what we can do to our own websites. Think about what our hackers could do to their websites. But to be a little more serious, I think the basic idea is that active defense is that it's a good offense, right? That we should, in the United States, take more active measures to launch cyber attacks on the locations and in countries, which is, I think, Steve Bradbury was mentioning, can be located through through intelligence and electronic signals intelligence to find out where these cyber attacks are coming from and threats coming from against us and trying to eliminate them. The problem, I think, and this is where the law becomes extremely important, is that I think our government seriously thinks about or may even consider cyber weapons to be governed by the laws of war in the same way or close to the same way that they govern normal weapons. So, for example, I think the Obama administration has taken the position that the use of cyber attacks can amount to an armed attack under the laws of war. If that's true, then think about what that does to the idea of active defense. That means that the United States could not use cyber warfare methods unless in our self-defense or when authorized by the United Nations, right, under the jus ad bellum idea. Or it could be that if they are in fact weapons, that they can only be used to target military personnel and locations and not civilians. And if cyber warfare are really weapons of war of the same kind that are used in regular armed attacks, it also means that we can't use cyber warfare to carry out retaliatory strikes or punishment strikes or preventive attacks, which I think is the idea behind active defense. So one thing I would say is that cyber warfare and cyber weapons open up different threats and possibilities, but they should also cause us to rethink whether the laws of war really do apply to these kinds of weapons. So think about the Stuxnet virus. Just take some of the examples we've been talking about. Stuxnet virus, we use this virus, or allegedly use this virus to delay the Iranian nuclear weapons program by somewhere estimates from 2 to 4 years. If that's true, and if the idea of cyber weapons, that they're less like regular weapons, did we not launch an armed attack on Iran when we introduced the Stuxnet virus? And would they not be entitled under the laws of war to launch a physical attack on Washington, D.C., or God forbid, Silicon Valley, right? I think that shows why the laws of war mechanically and artificially applied to this new world are inflexible and actually would harm our security, but also if you think about lead to more loss of life perhaps than a more flexible view, which is the whole point of the laws of war altogether. Or think about attacks to shut down parts of another country's networks, right? So maybe you could target the networks that are used by military intelligence in China. But suppose you can't do that. Suppose you instead choose to shut down the electricity grid in a city, or you choose to shut down the financial markets in another country, but for short periods of time. Right? Under the laws of war, those would be forbidden, right? Because those are targeting civilian networks. But we already do things like that in wartime. Right? We actually, if you're someone who's more of a lover of the United Nations, as I have to confess I am not, but if you are, people on that side of the ledger really love the idea of economic sanctions. Right? Are not economic sanctions the imposition of harm on a whole civilian population, right, as a way to force that country to come to terms? Right? Why can't cyber weapons be used in the same way to inflict harm on another country, but in limited, non-lethal ways that make life inconvenient for them, make life difficult for them, don't kill anybody, but as a way to force them to come to terms and settle some international disagreement we have with them? Think about what we did in Kosovo. In the Kosovo War, in order to try to convince Slobodan Milosevic to stop ethnic cleansing Kosovo, remember President Clinton ordered the dropping of these special bombs made out of graphite onto the electric transformers in Belgrade just to shut the electricity network down in the country for a week. And after that strike, 70% of the electrical network in Serbia went offline. The whole idea of that is not to specifically target military sites, but to put pressure on a population to get them to stop something that we don't like. And I think, and I'll close, is that I think what you're seeing these days are people who want to apply a sort of laws of war framework designed for completely different kinds of weapons and different kinds of wars to this. You're seeing proposals now for international treaties and agreements to try to regulate cyber warfare. If you look at the history of new kinds of weapons, they always prove themselves very difficult, if not impossible, to regulate by international agreement. And in fact, I think often the democracies lose out. Think about what happened in the interwar period and efforts to limit, say, naval fleets and weapon systems. The dictatorships all cheated, and the democracies didn't. And the United States and other democracies relied on those international agreements, much to their regret. And most of these weapon systems, like submarines, airplanes, and so on, were all used. And eventually, over time, after nations had experience with their usage, could they develop actually the legal rules that should apply to these kinds of weapons. And I think that's the best thing that we could do now, is to be more willing to use active defense and use cyber weapons to stop attacks on the United States. Hopefully, in my view, that would prevent the things which I think the ACLU is right to worry about, and the things that Joel and C worry about, that we might cross a line into things we don't want to happen in the domestic civilian world because we're unwilling to launch attacks to stop cyber warfare at their source.
Paul, would you comment?
Sure. I'm going to take this topic in a slightly different direction. What John has really talked about is the public law issues of laws of armed conflict and governmental uses of force. I want to ask, transition the question and ask, you know, what rights or responsibilities or limitations are there or ought there to be on private sector actors? Because the truth of the matter is that the subject of an attack from somewhere outside the United States is not necessarily going to be just the Pentagon, but it's also going to be some piece of critical infrastructure, 85 to 90% of which is owned by a private citizen, a corporation, an electric grid company, a transportation system, a medical system, a wastewater treatment plant. And what are their responsibilities? And I always sort of have in my mind this image from World War II. You know, if I had been the head of manufacturing at General Motors, punching out tanks on an hourly basis for the U.S. Army to take over to Europe to fight Nazi Germany, and the bombers had come over, and the government looked at me and said, well, no, you're responsible for having the anti-aircraft guns. We're not going to do that portion of it. You were on your own for your defense. We'd have all thought that was sort of nuts. We'd have assumed that provide for the common defense was exactly what the Constitution demanded that the government do in a time of armed attack. But in the cyber context, that's pretty much how we play right now. People who own critical infrastructure are more or less on their own for defense. And the real downside is that if they defend themselves too vigorously, they are themselves guilty of crimes. The Computer Fraud and Abuse Act makes it a crime to interfere with somebody else's computer, and that applies just as readily to your own defense of your own network by interfering with the hacker's computer that is attacking you as it does to his criminality in attacking you in the first instance. Likewise, it's almost certain that any effort I as GM or the electric grid undertake to defend my network here in the United States will have adverse impacts outside the United States. So in addition to violating American federal law, I am almost certainly violating the law of Germany, say, where the attacking computer is, or Russia or China. And when I'm a Chinese hacker hacking into the United States, I don't care about that because I'm beyond legal process and I can't be affected. But if I'm a good American company with assets in Germany, say, or coordinating relationships with German companies, I worry about the nature of my activity overseas as well. So what I would submit to you kind of in thinking about this structure is that we're in a fundamentally immoral position. The US government is not in a position to fully defend all of the private sector networks that we have, and indeed the steps that it would be necessary for it to take to do that in many ways would be exactly the sorts of steps that would freak out libertarian friends on the right and our liberal progressive friends on the left, like the ACLU, if the NSA were in fact, or Cyber Command were in fact defending the entire network, a degree of intrusion would be significant. But at the same time, we've legally disabled private sector actors from anything other than a passive Maginot Line type of self-defense. This is not a stable legal result in the end. I'm not sure I know what the best answer is going forward, but I do know that where we are right now is a formula for failure.
Steve, how would you approach this bundle of issues?
Well, I think precisely because of what Paul just said, we can't defend all of the networks, public and private, in the country from cyber intrusions. Cybersecurity cannot be achieved by simply sitting back within Fortress America and putting up firewalls to protect incursions from coming into our networks. Active defense is necessary. Our networks interact with and extend around the world with other networks, and our government, in order to protect the security of the United States and these critical computer networks, must have the capability, outward-facing capability, to probe those external networks, find the sources of the incursion, block them, identify them, block them, interdict them, undermine them, and maybe be more offensive in terms of taking action to target foreign computer targets, as John was mentioning. So we have to have that active defense. It's part of cybersecurity, an integral part. So I want to return to the public law aspects, because that role has to be played ultimately by the government. Private network operators really cannot effectively undertake those activities. And I want to make a distinction between an offensive activity in cyberspace that may, if serious enough, constitute an attack or use of armed force under the laws and customs of war, and something that's more like espionage, the exploitation of those networks. That's a critical part, too. We need to understand what's going on. We need to know the information that those foreign governments are using in those networks to attack us. And that's not subject to restrictions under the laws of customs of war. That's espionage. Both of those activities are a critical part of an active defense. And in the United States, currently, the way the president has set it up, it's conducted by Cyber Command. It is an element of our Defense Department. It's undertaken by the same director who also has the hat of directing the NSA, because that's where the computer capabilities reside in our government. But because it's part of the military, one of the things, you know, and I guess I'll go, this is a variation on what John was saying, and maybe I disagree slightly. The Department of Defense, when it engages in activities, whether in whatever domain, cyber is just another potential theater of military activity, the Department of Defense always complies with the laws and customs of war. So we need to grapple with those issues. And if we are engaged in something that could be described as an offensive use of cyber to try to interdict a foreign threat and maybe erase the data or take control of a foreign network to stop that or prevent that threat from hitting us, then that activity will need to comply with the laws and customs of war. DOD won't execute on that execute order from the president unless it does comply. But my view, and I've written this before, is that the rules under the laws and customs of war of how they apply to offensive uses of cyber capabilities are not settled. They don't begin to be settled. It is in flux. It's customary law. It's developing. And what the United States does and the rules we decide to live by will have a significant effect on shaping what those rules are in the future. So, and I think that's a good thing. I think it's a good thing for our national defense. I think it's a good thing for our national interests. And so it's up to the president to be active in terms of setting policy on what types of use of cyber the president is going to treat as an armed attack or a use of force that doesn't rise to the level of an armed attack. And I think you can have a use of force under the UN Charter, as I think John was suggesting, that doesn't arise to the level of an armed attack and doesn't give rise to a right of self-defense or military response. But those are rules of the road that I think it behooves the United States to take leadership in terms of developing through our own policies, our own actions. And I think the president has a wide range of discretion in doing that. I don't think it's in our national interest to try to negotiate a Geneva Convention for cyber war, not anytime soon. I think the Russians would love to do that. They've said that. And I think that's because it's not in our national interest to constrain ourselves with artificial aspirational rules that haven't yet developed as these practices occur.
Now, in any, quote, cyber war, ground zero would be the power grid. That is a critical infrastructure sector. Last time I looked, Homeland Security had like 17 critical infrastructure sectors, everything except, you know, the fashion industry. But certainly the power industry is there. In an attempt, and in other identifiable critical infrastructure areas, there's a movement towards regulation. There's a current executive order that's setting in motion a regulatory framework, and I'm going to ask Joel to comment, to expand on that, and to give us his sense of whether the burdens and benefits are fairly proportioned in those proposals.
Yeah, I think the administrative stuff is mainly aspirational. It's we couldn't get a bill passed, and we're not going to get a bill passed, and so here's some things we'd sort of like to see people collectively doing. Let me begin, though, by asking what we mean by critical infrastructure. And I'm not asking for a lawyerly definition. You can go to the regulations, and it says in Federal Register kinds of language what you would think in common sense. But let's just run through some of the major types of critical infrastructure, and then, because I think doing that will illuminate the difficulty of generalizing about critical infrastructure. We have an electricity grid. Belongs at the top, Vince, right about that. The electricity grid itself comprises some very large commercial companies, some very small municipal and not so small municipal companies that are publicly owned, and some very small rural cooperatives. These three classes of generators, transmitters, and retail sellers are not cut out of the same cloth. They have wildly differing standards of security and sophistication and understanding at all about cybersecurity. And some of them, because they don't want the guy who goes out to the field stations to have to get out of his truck on a rainy day, they want him to be able to stay in the truck and communicate with the field station by Bluetooth. That's our electric grid. And in the traditional thinking about the electric grid, you didn't have to worry about these small guys. You only worried about the big ones going out. But that's if you're thinking physical security. Once you get into a system, you don't care where you got in. You're in. And if you can worm your way up to massive major gateways through some small municipal or cooperative generator, it doesn't matter how you got in. You can do the same mischief as if you got in through Con Ed. Another vertical is banks and securities exchanges and the Fed. These guys are the best in our country and in the world at cybersecurity, for the simple, except the gaming industry, which is not critical infrastructure, because those two lines of work involve lots of money. And people who handle lots of money and make lots of money are real careful about how they handle it and how their systems work. That's not true of other lines of work. We have air traffic, and those are, some of those are private, some of those are quasi-public and regulated heavily, and some of those are the Fed itself, which is totally public. We have moving along to the air traffic control system, totally publicly controlled, but the flight management systems in aircraft are privately owned. And if you can get into one of those, and there are now hacker conventions devoted to being able to do it, you could corrupt air traffic control and perhaps bring down an airplane. That would be hard. I don't want to indulge in just wild scares. But there are people thinking about how to do that. That is part of critical infrastructure. The metro switches, the switches on railways, the controls on drilling rigs in the North Sea, or in our case, the Gulf of Mexico, or off the California-Virginia coast, critical infrastructure. The controls on refining plants, critical infrastructure. Now, the bills that were introduced in each of the last two legislative sessions began with some, I thought, overly aggressive attempts to impose federal controls on these. It was a non-starter. I favored, frankly, the most recent bill, which also failed, which simply wanted the various verticals in critical infrastructure to develop their own standards so that, for example, the small, local, municipal, and cooperative, and less good, larger commercial generators would have to get up to snuff. As Paul was saying earlier, I think it was you, Paul, a red team on the grid produces some very scary results. And although the Chinese don't want to bring down our economy because it would bring theirs down too, and the Russians don't either, we couldn't say that about the Iranians, for example, who are now are currently conducting extremely intensive denial of service attacks on American banks. Now, that's not the same as saying they get into their operating systems, because our banks are pretty good at it. But the banks saw in August of last year Iranian attacks on Saudi Aramco and Rosgas in the Gulf, for example. The Iranian attack on Saudi Aramco wiped out all the information on 30,000 computers and rendered them junk. And so our banks are taking this very seriously. I mean, if you were to take down a couple of major banks, the economic consequences for the country would dwarf that of 9/11. And in the wake of Stuxnet, the Iranians are working hard to be able to do that. Now, one of the things about this list that ought to be clear is that the boundaries between public and private are disappearing. It's nice to be able to say we've got to honor these boundaries of public, private, domestic, foreign, but they are all hard. These problems are all hard now. And the reason that the common defense has not up till now included our networks is because we do not want the government living in our networks. That is the problem, the nature of the problem we are struggling with. Similarly, I mentioned in passing the boundary between what's foreign and domestic. NSA collects against a terrorist who's using Google overseas, and it's reported as if NSA is collecting against Google's own communications. It's foolishness. But we are now, in order to collect foreign intelligence, having to crack encryption on an American company. These are hard problems, very hard problems. Now, the regulatory possibilities basically boil down to two, and neither one of them has happened and is likely to happen in the next year or two. One is, God forbid, we'd have federal standards on how these companies ought to do business. That is, I just think it's not going to happen. Nobody is really proposing it. That would be a disaster. The second is you could have requirements that industry set their own standards, but as I said, that fell apart partly over questions of immunity. It was never clear to me why we needed to give immunity to companies for obeying standards that they created themselves, and over the ability of the federal government supposedly to step in if industry failed to set those standards. In any case, it didn't happen. The federal, you know, the impetus out of the White House now is extremely weak, and we are left with, I think, attempts at NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology, to produce what I'll call hortatory standards that might be adopted. It's really important when looking at these standards, and if you spend some time in purgatory reading NIST standards or the standards of ISO, the International Standards Organization, they do great work, actually. One of the things you realize after dealing with the horrifying intricacy of these standards and they don't tell you brush your teeth. They say, here's the kind of toothpaste you need, and here's how you take the cap off, and here's how much you put on the brush, and that sort of thing. You realize that they are not actually setting conduct standards. They are telling you things to think about. That's useful. And one of the things that could come from the promulgation of these NIST standards is the emergence of a standard of care. I'm talking tort law now. Tort law has been remarkably ineffective because of shrink wraps and imposed contractual terms. Tort law has been remarkably ineffective in controlling bad quality hardware and software. One of the things that the NIST standards could do would be to, they might be seen eventually as a standard that if a company doesn't take these things into account and take reasonable steps to address those things, that it might face some liability. That, in my opinion, would be good.
That seems pretty likely to to happen. Paul, what are your thoughts on this?
Well, I guess I'm much less sanguine than Joel. I think disaster is just around the corner, and the government takeover of the network is ahead of us, okay? Now, I say that provocatively, but I am deeply skeptical that voluntary hortatory standards that are under development by NIST will remain voluntary, hortatory, and advisory. The Federal Trade Commission has asserted under Section 5 of the Federal Trade Act the authority to regulate cybersecurity and consumer organizations as unfair and deceptive practices. I predict that once the NIST standards are completed, the Federal Trade Commission will use them as the definition of what you must do in order to avoid liability for being an unfair or deceptive with respect to consumers. So that's all the consumer people in the business. I predict that all of the agencies, sector-specific agencies that regulate the energy community, the transportation community, the chemical community, the health community, FCC, FTC, FOC, all the Fs and Cs in America, will take those same standards and use as much of their regulatory authority as they possibly can to force them as into mandatory standards. And I predict that the tort lawyers, who Joel mentioned at the end, will catch everybody else. If you're not a consumer organization or in the critical infrastructure, you'll be a tort law responsible for not exercising reasonable care as against those standards. Because after all, what could be more unreasonable than ignoring the bulging brains of the National Institute for Standards and Technology? Now, all of that wouldn't be a problem at all if I thought that the NIST standards were going to be effective. But I don't. And the reason I don't is because this dynamic environment changes far too rapidly for any set of standards that are written on paper to be of any great use in the long run in defending a network. They will instead become little checkboxes that you mark off that you've done in order to avoid liability without actually producing a lot of security. If you want the proof of that, just ask yourself this question. What is the average time that it takes a major rulemaking like the NIST security standards to do in the United States? What is our average time for a major rule? You can look it up. It's about 18 to 36 months. That's what we've been averaging for the last 15 years. In that time, the processing power of computers doubles. The storage the cost of storage halves, and it's a logarithmic scale. We can't write rules fast enough to keep up with a world in which 10 years ago, Facebook didn't exist. And today, if it were a country, it would be the third largest country in the world. I have a very dim view of the capability of the government regulatory leviathan, even in a hortatory way, being able to keep up with that kind of dynamic and ever-changing environment. And yet I fear, perhaps unreasonably, but then again, you know, they told me that nobody would ever use my social security number for anything else, right? I fear that these voluntary standards will either, by hook or by crook, or perhaps by subsequent change of law, become mandatory, and then we'll be locked into standards that are too old, too slow, and that, in fact, kill the innovation that will come out of Silicon Valley, where somebody's next great idea will not be marketed, because it won't meet the standards that we've created, because it thinks orthogonally to whatever it is we're thinking about today, and it's a brand new way of addressing the problem that's more effective, works better, but if you make it, you can't sell it to the federal government, so nobody's going to invest in it. That's my dim view of it.
Michelle, what's your take? Are you as skeptical as Paul?
Actually, no.
No.
I'll be quick because I know we're running out of time here. I think you should think about regulation as a good privacy-neutral way to start raising cybersecurity across the board. And by across the board, I mean critical infrastructure. I think there's a lot of talk about these regulations bearing down on small companies who won't be able to meet the standards, but it doesn't apply to them. It applies to critical infrastructure. And companies that are defined as having a central role in the operation of our society, those have always been subject to higher standards because if they fail, our civilian population will absolutely suffer. I won't go into the detail of what they should include, but I should say I was at the NIST workshop yesterday and have been through these guidelines that they're promulgating. And they are tech neutral, and a lot of them are very basic stuff that you would really hope that critical infrastructure wouldn't have to be told to do. Like, can you take an inventory of all of your hardware? But you know what? There are companies out there that would fail that. Do you have a password management system? You know, there have been studies. Things like this are not being done for people who have to control very important industrial control systems, for example. They found that a huge chunk of people who ran energy systems never changed the password when they installed their software. So we've got all of these electric grids out there. We're worried about the Chinese hacking into them. The password's 1234 on all of them. I mean, come on now. There are some really basic things. You know, a lot of companies, they couldn't tell you how many computers, Blackberries, Bluetooths that they have. And so to the extent that there are some really important things in there that are a very agreeable floor that everyone should be meeting, that should be included. I'll just wrap up real quickly by saying, you know, the other side of cybersecurity is making sure that consumers' data is secure. And there's a lot that individuals can do, and we actually like the individual support and people defending themselves by smart cyber hygiene. But at some level, the owners and operators are in a position to provide cybersecurity that no individual can provide to themselves, or even a company, no matter how large it is. And so we do need to make sure that those people are doing a basic level of care for all of our sake.
Yeah, I don't agree with you, Paul. Here's why. The standards that are coming out of NIST are not prescriptive technical standards. They are very, very general. And your view of the world would leave us in a terrible spot, because we're not going to have, thank goodness, European-style regulation. You don't want us to have bodies with like NIST that have big private sector inputs developing general standards. And you don't want the tort lawyers to be able to sue for bad products. Your scary scenario will paralyze us and leave us exactly where we are now, which is profoundly unsatisfactory. I think that the FTC is doing the right thing. It's inconceivable to me that the FTC is going to use Section 5 to come up with prescriptive technical standards. That's a bogeyman. They are going after companies that are doing two things. They say they're doing one thing and they're not doing it, or they're doing nothing at all and making their customers' data wildly vulnerable. That's good.
Steve, you've alluded to this before, but could you elaborate on the question of the hour? What's the effect of Snowden on all of this? Of the NSA surveillance program disclosures, what impact will they have on real cybersecurity?
Well, thank you, Vince. To me, it's pretty clear that the Snowden leaks and the publications, press reports and publications of the information and documents that he's leaked have had and will have a very damaging effect on cybersecurity of the United States and of our allies. When we think about the Snowden leaks and the reports based on that information, we think mostly about surveillance programs and the harm that has been done from the disclosure of NSA data collection and surveillance programs and the pressure that these disclosures have put on our relationships with foreign intelligence services and our ability to conduct surveillance to protect the country. But I think that we need to recognize that cybersecurity too is impacted here and is really at risk. Just in today's, and I brought my personal clipping service here, I guess, today's Washington Post reports that yesterday the new director of the FBI testified that cybersecurity threats are emerging as the number one national security threat to the United States and are increasingly becoming the primary point of attention for our intelligence agencies and including the FBI. So I think we can assume that a lot of this surveillance that the NSA is conducting that's been exposed by Snowden is directed not just at counterterrorism or direct kinetic attacks or plots to conduct attacks by terrorist groups, but also it's cyber threats. Cyber threats from foreign governments like China, Russia, cyber threats from international criminal organizations or international terrorist organizations. I think we should assume that Al-Qaeda has a cyber wing and is working on the potential for a cyber 9/11, which might actually be easier for them to conduct in the future than an actual kinetic attack. So a degradation of our surveillance capabilities also, we have to understand, is impacting our cyber security that way. And of course, as we talked about in terms of the need for information sharing, in today's climate with these disclosures and reports and the public debate over them, it's much less likely that private parties are going to be sharing information with the government that's needed for cybersecurity. But let me turn to a more direct impact of these disclosures on the cybersecurity of the United States and allies. Back on August 30th, Bart Gellman and Ellen Nakashima in the Washington Post reported, U.S. spy agencies mounted 231 offensive cyber operations in 2011, documents show. They detailed this in an article published in the Washington Post, and they attached to the Post website copies of documents from the classified budget of the NSA and our intelligence agencies focusing in on offensive cyber operations. And in some detail, additionally, under an extensive effort codenamed Genie, U.S. computer specialists break into foreign networks so that they can be put under surreptitious U.S. control. Budget documents say, talk about covert implants, et cetera. This is all based on Snowden leaks. That's cybersecurity. That's the active defense that we were talking about. So this is exposing active defense cybersecurity operations. If that doesn't have a harmful effect on the capabilities of the United States to conduct those operations, I don't know what would. September 5th article, New York Times. Three top reporters for the New York Times lay out in great detail the headline, NSA able to foil basic safeguards of privacy on the web. The agency has circumvented or cracked much of the encryption or digital scrambling that guards global systems. The agency treats its recent successes, I appreciate this reporting by the Times, the agency treats its recent successes in deciphering protected information as among its most closely guarded secrets. The Times loved reporting that. Restricted to those cleared for a highly classified program codenamed Bull Run, according to the documents provided by Snowden. The agency, according to the documents and interviews with industry officials, deployed custom-built superfast computers to break codes and began collaborating with technology companies in the United States and abroad to build entry points. The NSA hacked into target computers to snare messages. It goes on and on with some detail, and again, disclosing the documents on the website that describe these cryptanalytic capabilities of the United States to break codes, to work with equipment manufacturers, to install things that are called, for example, backdoors or trapdoors, so that our intelligence agencies can gain access to communications networks overseas, not just to do surveillance, but also to interdict those cyber threats, which our FBI director just said are now becoming the number one national security threat to the United States. So this is integral to our cybersecurity capabilities. And the reporters of the Times reported in great detail about the internal documents saying how super sensitive this information was, how close held it was within our intelligence agencies and the British intelligence agencies. And then the New York Times proudly reported 5 days after that, that as a result of their own reporting, NIST, which we were just talking about, the federal agency charged with recommending cybersecurity standards, said Tuesday that it would reopen the public vetting process for an encryption standard after reports that the National Security Agency had written the standard and could break it. So clearly we're, as a result of these disclosures and press reports, degrading our own government's ability to institute protective measures to address cybersecurity threats. And again, today's Wall Street Journal reports, NSA fallout, tech firms feel a chill inside China. This is a direct result of these disclosures and these reports. It says big U.S. computer and software companies are reporting a sudden chill in sales to China, and some blame increased government hostility toward the U.S. Cisco Systems is reporting last quarter its sales in China fell 18%. And it says Cisco executives were among the most explicit so far in suggesting that Chinese customers, particularly those with government ties, may be cutting purchases of U.S. tech gear in response to U.S. restrictions on Chinese companies and revelations about surveillance by the National Security Agency. So the Chinese do read the New York Times, and they do read the Washington Post. And when things are published in the Post or the Times, as opposed to just some blog someplace, or Snowden's own ruminations, or perhaps a lesser-known newspaper in some third country, when they read something in the Post and the Times by these reporters, they assume those reporters have vetted the information and that the information is reliable. And it has a much greater impact when the New York Times actually makes a decision to publish it. And the New York Times had its little paragraph in that September 5th article where they said, you know, we were asked by the United States government and the British government, please do not publish this information because it would have an extremely damaging effect on national security and of both countries and our allies. But the Times said, we think the debate over the public disclosure of this information and the fact that the government is undertaking activities that actually undermine encryption and security systems is enough of a public interest that it should be aired. So the New York Times and the editors at the New York Times made their own unilateral decision as to what national security, what the balance of security and public interest should require in terms of disclosure. And I guess I'll close with a provocative suggestion. And that is, well, I think it's indisputable, actually. The suggestion in the article was that it's the activities of the NSA to work with equipment makers and break these encryptions and be able to get into these systems that is the threat to cybersecurity. When I would suggest it's in fact the leaks from Snowden and the publication, perhaps even more so, in these mainline press sources and newspapers about the details of this information that has the most dire impact on cybersecurity. And I guess the last thing I'll say is, you know, there is a criminal statute. It's in the Title 18 of the Criminal Code that does make it a crime to publish communications intelligence information about the communications intelligence programs of the United States and cryptologic systems of the United States. And I would just, a historical note, back in the Pentagon Papers case, New York Times versus the United States, when the court held that it was not appropriate to impose an injunction preventing the New York Times from publishing the Pentagon Papers, that would be a prior restraint and would violate the First Amendment. There were a lot of different reasons given by the justices for that view, and one of the leading ones was Justice White, Byron White, in his concurring opinion. He said, the reason I agree that we shouldn't enjoin this is because there are criminal statutes on the books, and if what the New York Times decides to go ahead and publish actually constitutes a disclosure of classified information, and he cited this particular statute, if it constitutes cryptologic information about cryptologic systems or the communications intelligence of the United States, they could be criminally prosecuted for deciding to publish that classified information. And Justice White went on to say that he, if the facts were such that it was a violation, would have no hesitation in upholding such a criminal prosecution. Now, I think today's Supreme Court, you know, it's a toss-up whether they would uphold that under the First Amendment, but we do have criminal laws on the books, and one might ask, if they're on the books, you know, why isn't somebody thinking about using them? Thank you.
We do need to get to questions, and the society needs this room for the Olson Lecture, so I'm just going to try to allocate mic time and go directly to John Yu for any comments on the Snowden question.
I can just wait for questions. My 3 points: one, Snowden's a traitor.
if he was such a do-gooder, he should come back and defend himself in open court. And the fact that he's not been brought back shows the Obama administration is feckless and weak in foreign policy. Done.
Joel, I'm sorry, you were slated, but do you want to go to questions?
No, I think let's go. We have some people who are going to get ornery if we don't get to them.
Right, so let's go to questions. Go ahead.
I think you, at least in my opinion, I believe you might be underestimating the worst case scenario and causing you to look at some of the wrong things, focusing on critical infrastructure, when, at least in my opinion, the worst case scenario would be zero-day vulnerability in Windows that, say, infects every computer in the country and causes them to malfunction and start a fire. Basically, it could burn down large portions of the country, potentially. That kind of attack would be far more deadly than just shutting off the power.
It'd be very hard to pull off.
I'm a privacy attorney in New York. I have clients out in Silicon Valley whom I deal with. Just two quick points and a question to the panel. The definition of privacy is often misunderstood. It's not the same as anonymity. Privacy is, in fact, the ability of people to control information about themselves legitimately in the hands of third parties.
Yeah, I don't agree with that, by the way.
But that's a definition that we use. But you don't.
I don't know who we is, but you know, I think that's
where'd that come from?
What you're saying says that.
Yeah. What statute says that?
Yeah. I mean, that privacy is a highly contested value. Some people see it as anonymity. Some people see it as autonomy. Some people see it as control. Perhaps we should let you ask your question, but you're starting by asserting a premise
let me confess then that's a privacy definition that is used in Europe among the European Privacy Commissions.
Yeah, exactly.
And also here in the United States among some privacy advocates. But the internet was constructed with two capabilities, and it seems to me only one of them was built out. Okay, the capability of the internet that was built, it's an open network. The capability that was built out was the location capability, websites. A website is a cyber location. The capability that was not built out and has never been built out is digital identity. Okay? We have the technical ability, which we've never implemented, of identifying digitally every object and every person on the face of the planet. If we were to do that, and it seems to me the trajectory is forcing us in that direction, whether we like it or not, there are a lot of policy questions about that, that would solve, I think, many of the issues raised by the panel. If you had a digital identity assigned to every person, to their information, to physical objects on the face of the planet, et cetera.
So let's wrap that into a question. So is that a good idea, and is that feasible?
No. The question of the panel is, if you conceive of these issues as identity issues, doesn't that in fact solve a lot of the problems that you're confronting as policy people in cyberspace?
No, I would say attribution, as they usually call it, is not the answer, because it's one of those approaches that actually is easily thwarted by the highest level people, but not the everyday users, right? And so you end up with something like the NSA phone call records program, where it's not effective for the actual purpose it's created, but the rest of us socialize the consequences. So we would oppose anything that would push the internet towards attribution.
I gotta say, I'm as conservative as anybody on the panel, but the idea of a universally identified system doesn't strike me as particularly advantageous. One of the virtues of the network is the anonymity it sometimes provides people to exercise freedoms without. I mean, we had Federalist, right? Publius, anonymous public pamphleteering. It's pretty traditional.
Protocol is now to go to the back and then back up front.
Thank you. Mr. Rosenweig, you made a good case for the inability of the government or regulators to rapidly react to cyber threats. Might you be able to arm all American cyber whiz kids, geeks, or geniuses with some form of letters of mark and reprisal and give them an incentivized means and authorization to go forth and burn our enemies, public and private, criminal, clown, or nation state, to the ground while securing their next, our network security and their next fortunes.
By the way, there's a serious law review article on that subject by Jeremy Rapkin out now.
Yeah, no, you know, the only thing that really troubles me about that is that the other countries of the world would also issue letters of mark and reprisal against American assets. And I mean, not the only thing, it is a reciprocal world. I think that we are going to probably move in the end towards some form of bonded and licensed, you know, active cyber defenses, kind of akin to bounty hunters or private police forces sorts of things, because we just don't have the resources. If for no other reason, we just don't have the resources.
Right? What do you think, Joe? As the only person on the panel has actually written a letter of mark when I was the NCIX, although I did it on the back of a napkin with a lot of gin on it, on condition it didn't leave the room it was in. Let me say, that's my jocular answer to the jocular beginning of your question, to the sober end of your question. The idea that we would turn loose individuals to possibly create consequences that could be extraordinary and damaging and that could then lead other persons to take action against the United States, both cyber and kinetic, of a very damaging kind, is not a condition we will tolerate under our law.
Mutual assured destruction?
It's mutual assured destruction in the hands of everybody who was in your fraternity house? I don't think so.
John pointed out that it was pretty clear that even Middle Eastern countries were planning cyber attacks on us. These folks aren't idiots. It seems to me, to some extent, certainly the major powers had a damn good idea of what we were capable of doing, not necessarily how we were doing it. So they couldn't have been really surprised by the Snowden disclosures. At least I'm drawing that conclusion. So to what extent does economic or other action going to change things? Or do you think that they were surprised to the extent of how much we were capable of building, of doing, particularly the major powers? It's just, they may have no, as I said, no idea, but they have to understand how science progresses. And it wouldn't take a genius to figure out, you go a few steps down the road and we're close to where we were.
I'll just say, this is the problem, right? You see two contradictory arguments from the government. On the one hand, these are the most evil geniuses our society has ever seen, and on the other hand, they're so dumb they can't even figure out that their cell phones might be tapped. I think it's probably more of, you know, these actors assume that they're under surveillance, and that's why they already take efforts to evade it. And I really don't think anybody was surprised about the power of the NSA.
Aren't they all doing
Look, I actually know something about this, so I'm going to claim a privilege to answer this one. Not to exclusion of anybody else, but I really want you to rethink what you've said. The first week that came out, Snowden said, we've been collecting Russian diplomatic communications. Now, no country is surprised that we might be trying it. They do it to us. The French weren't surprised. The Brazilians weren't surprised. That's theatrical hypocrisy at a high level. But did the Russians know we were doing it? They must have concluded from what came out in week one that we'd stolen or broken their codes. That kind of operation can take 8 or 10 years to pull off. It probably took them 20 minutes to close down those channels. Okay? That's one. Number two, we've lost. We don't have to guess about this and talk about, hypothesize how terrorist networks act, because we know. And we have lost a tremendous number of actual people we were covering. The take at the fort has dropped dramatically. Now, why is that? Because Michelle says, and she's right, that, you know, if you ask people, you know, can anybody collect against you? Yeah, well, maybe they can. And if you ask an American businessman, well, you know, aren't you vulnerable? Yeah, maybe I am, but I got to do business anyway. They don't get any better. When you log on to, in the military or an intelligence agency, to a machine, you get warnings about the dangers of these machines. Everybody who logs on has been trained over and over and over again in, with that, but they see it every day. People still make mistakes. Intelligence agencies live on people's mistakes. And so, although when once you start hitting people over the head with a 2x4, day in and day out with this, they start to change their pattern. That's what's happened.
I apologize for the last questioner, but the commander-in-chief of this conference has just given me this symbol, and so it's either my neck or yours, so we're gonna stop here. We're going to thank the panel for their time and wisdom.